Channel 5, the Texas News Channel, presents Charles H. Duggan's production of Greater Tuna, starring Joe Sears and Jason Williams.
Crazy, I'm crazy for feeling so lonely. I'm crazy, crazy for feeling so blue.
This is radio station OKKK in Tuna, Texas, serving the greater Tuna area at 275 watts, signing on.
Good morning, Tuna. This is Thurston Willis.
And this is Arliss Struve.
And this is the Willis
Struve
Report.
And here we go with the news. Take it away, Thurston.
Well, folks, in the news today, we have the winners of the Tuna Junior High American Heritage Essay Contest for this year. And this year's winner is Connie Karp. She's a daughter of W.H. and Vera Karp here in Tuna, and the name of her essay was titled Human Rights, Why Bother? Now, second place went to Jimbo Beaumont for his Living with Radiation, and third place went to LaVita Posey for her essay titled The Other Side of Bigotry. I'll tell you, Arliss, with subjects like that, I don't know how they ever picked a winner.
I don't either. I tell you, it should make the citizens of Tuna proud to know that we're still producing well-educated students who know what America's all about.
They do. I've always thought they'd done a
Thank
fine
you,
job.
Thank you, Ronnie. Got a message here. This just, excuse me, Thurston.
Right ahead.
Oh, I have bad news for the greater Tuna area. Former County Judge Roscoe Buckner died at his home yesterday. He had suffered a severe stroke. Buckner, who was judge in the greater Tuna area for 47 years and who hung more people in the 30s than any other active judge. Well, he had a history of heart trouble. Now, the body will lie in state at Hubert Funeral Home starting today at 12 noon. Wexler Hubert says if you come before noon, you're going to have to wait because the judge won't be ready till noon.
Well, I'll tell you, folks, that's some bad news.
It is. Now, on the art scene, the on-again, off-again auditions for the Tuna Little Theater production of My Fair Lady are on again. They've been called off due to a lack of budget, but Joe Bob Lipsy, who's the director of the show this year and who is a recent graduate of Southwest Texas Eastern A&I State University, said that he found a way to go ahead with the production by using sets and costumes from last year's show, A South Pacific. And according to Joe Bob, it's going to be the first production ever of My Fair Lady set in Polynesia.
Yeah. Well, you never know, Arliss, something like that is liable to put us on the map.
On it. Joe Bob says, get on your Hawaiian shirts, your grass skirts, your coconuts, and get out there to that Coweta Baptist Church. 8:30 Thursday night, an audition for My Fair Lady. Joe Bob says he wants to integrate the cast this year, so if you know any Negro or Mexican-American actors or actresses, have them come on out and try out for the chorus.
That's right. Come on out.
Come on.
Come on now. Come on. You never know. You just might get a part.
You might. Thurston, you got that farm report?
Yeah, I got that farm report. Well, folks, it's going to be an incomplete farm report because not everything is in just yet. But I've got beef up, pork down, chickens vacillating. And I don't know that much about sowbillies, but I do know it's time for a word from our sponsor, D.D. Snavely of D.D.'s Used Weapons. And here's D.D. now to tell us all about it. D.D.?
Does the high cost of security have you blue? If so, come down to the store and browse through our complete selections of used guns and knives, or find what you need in our mace and tear gas department. Now, we understand that many people are hesitant to buy used weapons, but all of D.D.'s weapons are absolutely guaranteed to kill. Now, you find a weapon here that won't kill, you bring it back, and we'll give you something that will. It's on our guarantee, if D.D.'s can't kill it, it's immortal.
Thank you, Dee. Thank you. Well, I'll tell you, it's always a pleasure to have Dee here with us. Thank you, Dee. And now for that weather report, we're going out there to the field with Haroldine Latimer. Haroldine, are you out there? What's it going to be?
Well, it's going to be a little bit of everything. We got a lot of rain coming in from the north and the west and the east and a little bit from the south. But by mid-morning, it should have cleared off. By noon, it should be unbearably hot and humid. We're expecting about 100, 101. Now, for the afternoon, we got some possible dust storms from out in West Texas. They could be severe. They say the sky could go completely black around 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And we also got this swarm of locusts that are heading our way from Louisiana. But we figure the dust will kill a lot of them. And the rest will probably get blown away or drowned in this tropical storm that's heading our way from the coast. That'll be Tropical Storm Luther. And that storm's going to hit here about 10 o'clock. It's going to bring a lot of rain with it. It's going to be wet, cloudy, miserable, and it's going to rain for several days. So get out them raincoats. Back to you, Thurston.
Well, folks, you heard it. Rain. You know, I think Haroldine has to get up every morning about 4:30 to give these weather reports. And sometimes we'll be driving to the studio and we'll look out there and just see him standing there in God only knows what kind of weather.
Oh, hell, I've seen him up to his neck in snow before.
Yeah. You remember the time he spotted that water spout over B. Miller Pond?
Picked him up, dropped him in Dewey County.
You did, yeah. He still got that report in on time.
He did. Thank you. Ronnie, this just in, a UFO, that is an unidentified flying object, has been spotted by R.R. Snavely over Lake Mobeady. R.R. says it looks like a gigantic hovering chalupa without the guacamole. That's what it says.
It does.
From our world news desk, peace talks fail, attack is imminent. Mm. That's all the news we got for you.
That's it.
Stay tuned. We got Leonard on the line.
Thank you, Ronnie.
I got
a note here. You forgot to throw the power switch. You are not on the air. This is Thurston Wheeler.
And this is Arliss Streeby.
And this is Wheeler Streeby. This is Elmer Watkins for Clan 249 on radio station OKKK. Now, I just want to remind everybody, we're going to have a meeting tonight down at the meeting house. We're going to talk about them sharecroppers down there by Hog Shooter Creek. Now, they've been taking up more than their share of the land down there. They ain't been leaving nothing for the wild game to live in. Come this fall, there ain't going to be nothing to kill, and that sport's going to be gone. I want everybody to show up tonight so we can plan out what we're going to say to them. I think they're going to listen. This is Elmer Watkins for Clan 249. Thank you.
This is Petey Fisk speaking to you for the Greater Tuna Humane Society. And I'd like to ask each of you to take a minute to think about ducks. Now, it's tough being a duck. Cartoons portray ducks as genetic mutants with speech impediments. Now, the very word duck, when used as a verb, means to rapidly lower body position to avoid injury. So when you say duck to somebody, they don't know whether you're talking about a bird or an accident. And the Chinese eat their feet.
Now, you may not know it, but we got a duck crisis situation right here in Tuna. Ever since the government flooded Buckner Basin, the wild ducks have got no nesting grounds left. We're up to our necks in homeless ducks. Now, to remedy the situation, Humane Society's published a pamphlet, Duck Trapping Without Trauma, and we're sending copies to every home in the area. Now, you bring the trapped ducks to me, Petey Fisk, and I'll personally relocate them in unflooded areas. This is Petey Fisk speaking to you for the Greater Tuna Humane Society. Thank you.
Crazy.
Charlene!
I'm crazy for feeling.
Stanley!
So lonely.
Don't make me call you again!
I'm crazy. Crazy for feeling.
Jody, you, Miller, get yourself in here and finish your breakfast. Jody, you want some more oatmeal?
No, Mama.
Well, honey, how about some more biscuits and gravy? Now, you hardly even touched them.
I already had some, Mama.
Baby, I could fry you some more bacon.
Mama, I don't want nothing.
Is there something wrong with them hash browns?
No, Mama.
Well, honey, have some more. Now, come on, I want you... Jody, what is that out there on the back porch? Oh, no. I will not have another puppy.
Mama, it followed me home.
Yeah, uh-huh. From where?
From Petey Fisk.
That Petey Fisk has given you another dog. He saves the dogs of the world and sends them home for me to feed. Well, you can't have another dog, Jody. 8 dogs is too many. You cannot have another dog, little Jody.
But I'll take care of it, Mama.
No, honey. It's not a matter of taking care of it. It's not normal. It's not normal for you to have 8 to 10 dogs following you all the time. Jody, don't let that dog in the house. Honey, that reporter from Houston will be here. Don't let the dog in the... Oh, isn't that the cutest thing? Oh, look at you. No, now stop that. Quit. Stop. Get down. Look, he has done it to me again. Come on, you. Come on, get on out there in the backyard with the rest of them. Yes, you. Now, come on, I got to sit for an interview. No, get back. Away from that door, all of you. Get back. Now, come on. There you go. She is so cute. No, you leave her alone. Swear, bless her heart, I'll kill that goddamn Petey Fisk. Stanley, you want some oatmeal?
Mm-mm.
Honey, how about a biscuit?
Uh-uh.
Will you try some hash browns?
Mama, get off. I'll get some M&Ms on the way to trade school.
Stanley, honey, man cannot live by M&Ms alone.
Mama, get off.
And don't lie to me about trade school. Vera Karp said you spent half the morning yesterday just sitting in your car out in front of the grocery store.
Well, Vera Karp can kiss my rusty butt.
Stanley, now don't stop.
Mama, I'd be just fine if Charlene had stopped
it. I wish to God you and your sister would stop that fight.
Yeah, I heard her up there groaning.
Stanley, she'll hear
Locks the door, turns on the water, starts groaning.
Stanley.
Mama, every time the groaning starts, I know she's trying to squeeze into another pair of my blue jeans.
Well, honey, you just may be big yourself someday.
If I am, shoot me.
Oh.
Well, Mama, she ripped the butt out of 3 pair of Wranglers in the last month.
Charlene! Charlene! Honey, I know you can hear me! Charlene, get out of Stanley's jeans now.
Yeah, her hips are so big she got to lay down on the bed and groan into her.
Stanley, will you stop it? Now, we're going to find her a good diet.
Yeah, you better find her a good surgeon.
Oh, just get out of here before you drive me to a rubber room at Big Spring. Charlene! Charlene, honey, get out of Stanley's jeans. You know you're too big to fit in them. It breaks my heart to hurt that baby's feelings.
Yeah. Yeah, I should have known you'd take her side.
Don't let those dogs in the house. Get off of that chair. I swear, better get out that door. Look at this mess, and I cleaned it. Bingo, bingo. What is that? Oh, bingo, get out of here. No, you come back here. Take that with you. Now go on, get outside. I swear, you dogs are going to be the death of me. Charlene, honey, will you hurry up? I know you're working on your poem for the radio show, but, sweetheart, your breakfast is getting cold.
Mother! Mother!
What?
Get up here and get this dog out of my room.
Which one?
Woofy.
Woofy, come downstairs. Woofy! There you go. Good old Woofy, look at you. Oh, I told you before about coming through that kitchen door. Time you come through that door. Now, I know a German shepherd gonna be looking for a new home. And you're next. Charlene, do you want some oatmeal?
No.
Well, honey, how about a biscuit? Well, will you try some hash browns?
No, thank you.
Well, here, honey, at least have a cup of coffee. Charlene, honey, stop it! Charlene, do you remember that agreement we made? That we were going to use sweet and slender in our coffee.
I used sweet and slender when I still had something to live for, Mother.
Oh. Charlene. Honey, what's wrong?
Nothing.
Well, why are you mad?
I'm not.
Charlene, snap! Honey, everybody can't be cheerleader. To live for.
Name one.
I can't think of any right now. But honey, when I do, I'll write them down and I'll give them to you.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. If that vicious little Connie Carp calls me two bits one more time, she better send out for bandages.
Honey, she's just like her mother. You kill her with kindness.
Yeah, I'll kill her with something.
You will do one to others. And don't let those damn dogs in the house. Get out of here. I've had it with... I wish you would get on that table. Trixie, Dolly, come on. You girls, no, Dolly! Trixie, outside. Now go on, you girls know better. Get on out that door. Yeah, oh, Woofy, you come through that door one more time and you'll need drugs to kill the pain. Now, I have had it! Oh, dear, it's that reporter from Houston. I'm coming. Well, I said I was coming. Well, you'll just have to hold on to your horses. I said I was coming. Yes.
Miss Buemiller?
Yes.
My name's Chad Hartford.
Oh, Mr. Hartford. Come in, come in. Could I get you something to drink? A cup of coffee?
Oh, I don't really care for anything to drink, Miss Buemiller. I'm in a bit of a hurry. Could we get right to the interview?
Well, certainly.
Now, let's see. You are chairing the censorship of the textbook committee, am I correct?
No. That's the Reverend Spikes who heads up that committee. Although I am a member, and we're going to have a meeting this afternoon, by the way, but please don't come. No, the Reverend Spikes, he just hates the press. I think it's because all of them old folks' homes he owns and all those terrible things they said about him in the newspaper. And, well, I better shut up. Well, anyway, I head up the subcommittee that wants to snatch the books off the shelves of a local high school library. Some of those books are absolutely disgusting. Our children have no business reading them. And somebody has got to protect the minds of the children.
Well, Ms. Buemiller, before we got to the books, could you tell me, what do you feel in your background qualifies you to censor library books?
Well, I can briefly list my activities, if you wish.
Please.
I'm currently president of the Ladies for a Better Tuna. I'm den mother for Den 223. I'm the only high C soprano in the First Baptist Choir. I'm currently recorder of the Javelina Club. That's a women's auxiliary, the Wild Hogs. It's a kind of a breakoff of the Lions Club. We just thought the Lions were too liberal. I'm former head of the local BBB, that's the Better Baptist Bureau. And I'm a member of our shut-in visiting squad, the Tuna Helpers. And I'm currently president and co-founder of Citizens for Fewer Blacks in Literature.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Buemiller. I think I got the idea.
All right.
What exactly are the books that you would like to see removed from the shelves?
Well, there are four of them that we're going to try and have removed nationwide, and then we're going to go from there.
Well, what are the four books, Ms. Buemiller?
Roots. We don't deny that Roots has been a very popular TV series, but we feel it only shows one side of the slavery issue.
Go on.
Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee. Well, it's the most disgusting title to begin with. It just makes me want to irk. That book vilifies a great American, General Custer, and encourages the reader to believe that the United States government can't be trusted in making any treaties.
Well, what's next?
Huckleberry Finn by Mark Twain.
Did he write that?
That book shows a pre-teenage boy avoiding his chores, running away from home, cohorting with a Negro convict, and putting on women's clothes.
Go on.
Romeo and Juliet.
What, pray tell, is wrong with Romeo and Juliet?
Well, it just shows sex among teenagers, that's all. And we're not for that. And we're certainly not going to encourage it. Besides, it does show a rampant disrespect for parental authority.
You are aware that William Shakespeare wrote that play?
Yes, we are. And we're looking into the rest of his stuff, too. Yes, we are. He wrote Barefoot in the Park, didn't he?
Ms. Buemiller, quite often these days people claim to talk to God. Do you talk to God?
Well, I pray.
I didn't ask you that, Ms. Buemiller. I asked you if you talk to God directly.
Well, no, I don't. But he leaves little messages for me. Well, he does with the Reverend Spikes and secondhand messages from the Lord is good enough for me.
Well, thank you, Ms. Buemiller. I think we got one hell of a story.
Well, now don't you rush off. I've got other interesting things to tell you about, too.
Well, I'm sure it just boggles the mind, Ms. Buemiller, but I really must run.
Well, now, wait a minute. What is the name of your magazine?
Intellect.
I don't believe we have that here in Tuna.
Well, I'll see that you get a copy. Goodbye, Ms. Buemiller.
Well, bye. Well, I think reporters ask the silliest questions. I guess I'm lucky he didn't ask me more than he did. Thank God he didn't ask me about my family. Poor Charlene. That girl, she's just going crazy over not getting cheerleader. And I said, Charlene, honey, settle down. It'll be fine. You'll get cheerleader next year. And she looks at me with tears streaming down her cheek and says, Mama, I'm a senior. I don't know how to tell my daughter she's never going to be cheerleader. I just don't know how to do it. And Stanley, I swear I don't know what I'm going to do with that boy. Dating that Mexican girl. He never has been right. And Jody, he's going to be okay. Except he's got 8 to 10 dogs following him all the time. Now, he's going to grow out of that. I know he will. And I hope. And at least I didn't have to lie about Hank. Not cooking clean for that sorry son of a bitch for 27 years, and he won't even take me to the drive-in movies. Of course, I pretend not to notice. Sunday mornings as we go to church, after Saturday night, after I have smelled the perfume and seen the lipstick smear, I swear, sometimes I wish that man would have a stroke. I swear I do. I don't mean that. God forgive me. I don't mean that. I'm so glad that reporter didn't ask.
And I'm crazy for loving you.
This is Arliss Struve with a news update concerning the recently deceased Judge Roscoe Buckner, who died yesterday. Now, the body was found by Nikki Mayberry, who'd gone over to collect for the newspaper, and Nikki wishes to quench all rumors that the judge was found dead in a women's bikini swimsuit. He says there's no truth to that rumor whatsoever.
It's not true.
It's not?
It's not.
It's not. It's not. According to Nikki, it was a 1950 turquoise Dale Evans one-piece swimming suit with lots of cow-gal fringe. Services are pending at Hubert Funeral Home.
Ain't that awful? Ain't that awful?
This is Petey Fisk speaking to you for the Greater Tuna Humane Society.
And I'm here to introduce this week's pet of the week. His name is Yippee-yay-yay-yay, but we just call him Yippee. That's why. This is Yippee's fifth appearance as pet of the week. And this charming little part rat terrier, part chihuahua, would make a lovely pet for someone. We're sure. Stop it! Now, his only drawback as a pet is a tendency towards hyperactive behavior. Stop it! Now, as you may well understand, we at the Humane Society often have trouble giving away small, shrill animals. But we still have hope for Yippee. We know there must be some deaf person out there who would love to have a dog and who would make the perfect owner for Yippee. Now, if there's any deaf person out there listening that wants this dog, please call me, Petey Fisk, at 477-7777. Call any time, day or night. please call. If you're out of town, call collect. I gotta get rid of this dog. This is Petey Fist speaking to you for the Greater Tennessee Humane Society. Thank you.
Hello?
Hello, Petey. Is this Petey Fist?
Yes.
Petey, this is Bertha B. Miller. I want to talk with you, and I want you to listen. Do you understand me?
Well, now, what are you talking about,
Bertha? I said, I want to talk, Petey, and I want you to listen. Petey, I have tried to think what I've done to deserve this life I lead. A husband who spent 4 years in prison for robbing a filling station of $47. And there are my psycho twins, Charlene and Stanley, who you know have caused me no end of grief. And my youngest, Jody, has never seen that he doesn't have a pack of dogs around him. They follow him home. They follow him to school. They follow him everywhere. And last week, Petey, I nearly had to whoop him. He wanted to take him to the First Baptist Church.
Now, Bertha, I think that's
cute.
I said,
I'll talk and you listen. Petey, we have a very serious situation on our hands. My son, Jody, has something as bad as a drug habit. Jody has a dog habit. He has a psychological addiction to those dogs. And you, Petey Fist, you're a puppy pusher.
Well, I never in my life.
I said I'll talk. Petey, I'll put up with Shep, Woofy, Trixie, Bingo, Blossom, Sweet Nothing, Dolly, and Thunder. But if that little yippy half rat, yippy half chihuahua, yippy half whatever that you've been talking about on the radio, if that dog shows up at my house, Petey Fist, they'll drag the river to find your body. I'm going to call my Aunt Pearl Burris. I swear to God, I'm calling Aunt Pearl and tell her to make up a whole batch of her bitter pills. I mean business. I'm as serious as a stroke. I will not be the mother of an addict, whether he's on opium or basset hounds. Now say goodbye, Petey.
Goodbye.
We interrupt this program with a news update. The recent sighting of a UFO, that is an unidentified flying object, by R.R. Snavely has been discounted by his wife, Dee Dee. According to Dee Dee, R.R. was drunk when he actually claimed to have sighted it, so she says everybody just forget about it. He was drunk.
Well, we all thought it was something like that.
We did?
We did.
We did, we did.
Hell, it had to be.
And now, folks, sit back and listen to the number one show in Dewey County on the line with Leonard, where your business is everybody's business. And now here's station manager Leonard Childers.
You gotta stop, look and listen. Hey, you don't know what you're missing. You gotta stop, look and listen, 'cause you might be missing kisses.
Hello, everybody. This is Leonard Childers coming into your home through radio station OKKK, where every day we take a few minutes to find out just what's up Tuna's Crawl. And I can see those telephone lines are already lighting up, and we'll take our first Let It Out call after we take a quick look at this week in Tuna. Now, I have a message here from the Reverend Spikes over at the Coweta Baptist. He says he's going to sponsor another record burning. He says to bring all your rock and roll, and this time you get your Chuck Berry, your Brenda Lee, and your Little Richard. He said you leave that Buddy Holly and Elvis at home. They're good Southern boys, and they'll be forgiven. That's his coming Sunday night down at the Coweta Baptist Church. So you bring your rock and roll, come on out and burn it. And let's see here now. Ida Thompson has organized another trip up to see the Eureka Springs Passion Play over in Arkansas. Ida says if you signed up, they're going to be leaving this coming Saturday morning at 7:45 a.m. from the First Methodist parking lot. Ida says if you're not there by 7:45, She's going to leave you. All right, folks, it's time for us to take our first Let It Out call. Hello, you're on the line with Leonard. Let It Out.
Leonard, Dee's name.
Dee, turn your radio down. Folks, you've got to remember to turn those radios down when you call in, because it blows the hell out of my ear. Hey. Let It Out, Dee.
Leonard. Leonard, can't something be done about them Halloween pranksters?
Well, it's kind of early for Halloween, ain't it, Dee Dee?
Oh, Leonard, you wouldn't say that if you knew what I'd been through. Now, Leonard, soaping windows and letting the air out of tires is one thing, but I draw the line at extreme mental anguish. Do you hear me, Leonard?
I hear you, Dee Dee.
Last year, them kids come over in the middle of the night, poured sorghum syrup all over my front porch.
That's real mean.
I'm just getting started. Now, Mama comes over every morning about 5:30 after she's had her prunes. And when poor Mama hit that thick syrup, it stopped her dead in her tracks.
Yeah, well, Dee, that's just real mean.
It's not funny, Leonard.
No.
She's out there for 2.5 hours. She watched the sun come up.
Dee Dee, who could think of anything that means?
Well, I'm sure Virgil Carp is in on it, but I can't prove nothing.
Yeah, well, that sounds just like something Virgil would do.
Well, if I catch him near my house, he better have a high threshold to pain.
Now, Dee Dee, we all know you wouldn't hurt that boy.
Hide and watch, Leonard. Hide and watch.
Yeah, well, Virgil, son, I'm telling you, if you're listening out there, the woman means business.
But, Leonard, the damage is already done. I can't even pour syrup on my pancakes without thinking of that poor, frantic little old lady trying to reach that doorbell.
Yeah. Well, now, Dee Dee, you just settle down now. There ain't no use of you, no use of you getting upset. Take one of your nerve pills.
Well, I believe I will.
All right. Thank you, Dee Dee. Well, folks, I'll tell you now. You know, it's just getting so the kids can't have any fun anymore. But you know, Dee Dee, she's had a real rough life down there running that store. She has a lot to let out. Hello, you're on the line with Leonard. Let It Out. Hello, you're on the line.
Am I on?
Yeah, turn it out!
Sorry, I forgot. This is Finest Blonde.
What's up, Finest?
I'm calling to announce that I will be a candidate for Tuna City Council in next year's elections.
Well, Finest, you've been running for City Council for as long as I can remember. Why don't you just give up?
Well, you know, it's funny. Now, in past elections, my opponents have made personality the major issue, and let's face it, in a personality contest, I'm always going to lose. I mean, I'm short, I was born in Indiana, and a lot of people just naturally seem to hate me.
Yeah, you're right there, Fine.
But this year, I'm injecting new and vital issues that cannot be ignored by the voters. Did you know, for example, that there are thousands of citizens in this country who pay no taxes whatsoever?
Like who,
Like
Fine?
Welfare mothers and prisoners.
They don't pay
No,
them.
And it'd be easy to tax the prisoners, because everyone knows where they are.
Well, you've got a good point there, Finus, and we wish you the best of luck this time around.
Well, you only have to win once.
Thank you, Finus. God, I tell you. Folks, there goes a man ahead of his own time. You remember now, you heard it here first. You know, Finus has been running for City Council for now on to 14 years, and he's never even made it to first base. You hang in there, Finest. Hello, you're on the line with Leonard. Let It Out.
That's Stanley Buemiller.
Stanley, what do you want? You keep it clean.
Well, I was just listening to your last phone call. It seems to me if the government's looking to tax something, why don't they put a tax on stupidity?
Stanley, this is a serious program. Get to it.
Hey, Leonard, I am serious. I guarantee you one thing. If this country had a stupid tax, Finest Blyde would be in the top bracket.
Stanley, Finus Bly is a model citizen, unlike some people I know.
Oh, yeah, he's an ignorant little idiot.
Now, there's no need to get into any name.
He's a pinhead idiot.
Stanley?
Hey, Leonard, why don't you tell Finus Bly to kiss my referendum?
Now, you can't say that on the radio! Folks, I'll tell you now, I don't want to say anything bad about Hank Buemiller's boy. But you know, we all hoped that year in reform school would have helped him. Hell, he came out meaner than Mussolini. You can't help some people, I reckon. We got time for one more call. Hello, you're on the line with Leonard. Let it out.
Leonard, D.D. Snively again.
Now, what's the matter this time, D.D.?
Leonard, can't something be done about them hobos under the interstate bridge?
Yeah, out there underneath that underpass.
Leonard, it's getting so crowded you can't even dump your garbage there anymore.
Yeah.
Stink. Stink. God almighty, stink. Hell, you can smell them in Coweta County. Now, Leonard, there is enough Camay in the world to keep everybody clean. Am I wrong?
Well, no, I believe you're right.
And
D.D.,
instead of minding the store, my husband, R.R., goes out there and drinks with them.
Well, D.D., is that where R.R. spotted that unidentified flying Mexican food? Huh?
No, it isn't, and it's real. Why do you to bring it up, Leonard?
Yeah, well, I just... Hey, turn off that damn thing. Damn, nice and stop.
Well, I don't know what's coming next, but this whole world's in a terrible fix. You gotta stop, look and listen. You gotta stop, look and listen. You gotta stop, look and listen. You gotta stop.
You've been listening to Leonard on the Line, and this is Arliss Truby. Got a news flash here. Sheriff Givens says Danny Palvador is out of the state penitentiary, and he's heading home in a 1962 Blue Impala. So everybody watch out for him. He'll run over you.
He will?
He will, he will. Hell, the man will kill you.
Oh, and now for that weather report, we're going out there to Buckner Basin with Haroldine Latimer. Haroldine, what's it going to be?
Well, in the weather, it's going to rain.
Mrs. Pearl Burris, General Delivery, Tuna, Texas. Dear Mrs. Burris. After a recent unsettling phone call from your niece, Bertha Buemiller, I feel compelled to write to you. As you know, relations have never been strong between the Humane Society and those who raise chickens. Now, we do understand that this is your livelihood, disgusting as it may be to those of us at the Humane Society.
Here, chicky, come and get it, babies. Eat it up. Eat it up, babies, eat it up.
We do feel, however, that you are posing a danger to the children of your neighborhood as well as their pets. We're sure you love the kids of your neighborhood as much as we do.
Get out of those tomatoes! Get out of them! I'll call Sheriff Givens. Let me at them.
Mrs. Burris, we've traced over 70 dog poisonings to your doorstep. Don't you think you've taken eccentricity a bit too far?
Oh, they've left that poodle in my yard. I bet it's an egg sucker. Where is it?
We feel you've been somewhat overzealous in the protection of your chickens.
Oh, Lord, where is my strychnine? Please, to God, don't tell me I'm out.
In fact, Mrs. Burris, there are those of us at the Humane Society who feel you actually enjoy poisoning dogs.
Well, I'll kill Henry if he's hidden my strychnine.
Now, we are well aware of your bitter pills, those strychnine lace biscuits rolled into enticing little dough balls.
Well, I found it. Henry thought he'd be smart and hide it, but I found it. I'm going to kill me a poodle. Now, where's my biscuit? I'm going to make you a bitter pill.
Now, we are also aware that your husband Henry is the owner of Ripper, the finest bird dog in Dewey County. How could anyone who lives around a $2,000 dog like Ripper poison people's puppies so heartlessly?
Here, puppy. Here, puppy. Get over here, egg lips. come on now, good boy. There you go. No, get back, Ripper. Stay back. It's not for you. You stay back, Ripper. It's not for you. Well, I didn't mean to scare you now. Come on, get over here. Come on, I'll leave that bitter pill right there. Come on, get up. No, Ripper, stop. Don't eat that, Ripper. Put that down. Oh, my God, Ripper's eating the bitter pill.
Mrs. Burris, you have classic symptoms of canicidal thumbitis, a disease that causes you to want to kill other people's dogs for real or imagined reasons.
Oh, my God, I've poisoned Henry's bird dog. Oh, look at him shake.
Now, the only known cure for canicidal thumbitis is to be surrounded by lots and lots of dogs until the urge to kill passes.
Oh, Lord, what am I going to do? Think, Pearl, think. Think. What am I going to do? I know what I'll do. I'll call Stanley. I'll have him come over here and drag that dog out in the road. Yeah. We'll run over it with the Pontiac. That's it. We'll tell Henry it got hit by a car.
And are you in luck, Mrs. Burris? The Humane Society has a one-way bus ticket for you to Dallas to the Texas State Dog Fair, where you can be surrounded by over 4,000 dogs.
Well, that's what I'll do. I'll call Stanley. I can count on Stanley.
Mrs. Burris, if you make it through the entire dog show without poisoning a single animal, the Humane Society will pay your bus fare home. Think. You can find peace of mind, and the dogs of your neighborhood can have a respite from the death and carnage to which they've been subjected. Sincerely, Petey Fisk, Greater Tuna Humane Society.
Oh, hello, Stanley. Yes, this is Pearl. Honey, get over here quick. I need you. Well, I want you to run over Henry's bird dog. Ripper? Well, he's already dead. I killed him. Well, Stanley, I know it's not as much fun running over a dead dog. Stanley, honey, please, to God, get over here now. I don't believe I can stand it. Well, you're a good nephew. All right, I'll see you in a minute. All right, goodbye. Well, I knew I could count on Stanley while he's here. I'll get him to run me down to the funeral parlor so I can view Judge Buckner. God, nothing would get me out in this heat except to see him dead. Well, I gotta see for myself, make for sure.
Pearl?
Stanley, is that you? Come out, come out.
Pearl? How come you poisoned Uncle Henry's bird dog?
Oh, now, honey, don't you say that. I didn't. It was an accident. I was after this egg-sucking poodle. And Ripper, he came up and snatched that bitter pill.
Well, Pearl, I always kind of liked old Ripper.
Yeah.
You know, Uncle Henry finds out you poisoned a $2,000 dog, he's gonna have a conniption fit.
Oh, God, he'll scream like a banshee.
Hell.
Quick, you drag that dog out in the road and we'll run over it.
Hell, Pearl, you're crazy.
Now, Stanley, honey, don't you say that. Now, I'm not. And Stanley, I want you to run me down to the funeral parlor so I can view Judge Buckner. You can wait for me at the Tasty Cream. I'll buy you an ice cream cone.
All right. Hurry up, Pearl. Get in the car.
Well, I'm coming.
Oh, come on. Hurry up, Pearl. I don't want nobody to see this.
Stanley. Honey, now don't rush me. I'm an old woman. Pump it. Now, Stanley, you make it look good.
All right.
Oh. To you.
my goodness, you look so waxy. Well, they've waxed you down, Judge, so you look good. You old son of a bitch. A stroke. It was your conscience that killed you. Those same tight little lips. Well, those beady little eyes will never see the light again, will they, Judge? Oh, Lord, what could have ever have made me want to love you? Tell me how could I? I guess a young girl can't be foolish. Then you were always too good for me, weren't you, Judge? Just too good. Well, that's all right. I took it. Then you sent my favorite nephew, Stanley, to reform school. And for what? Spray painting stop signs. Well, you might as well have killed him, Judge. He's never been the same. And I told you then, I would sing over your grave when you died. And, Judge, I feel a song coming on. Oh, the fox went out one stormy night. He prayed for the moon to give him light. He said, I've got many miles to go before I reach the town, oh, town, oh.
Why, Pearl Burris, is that you?
Oh, Vera Carp, how are you?
Virgil! Virgil, honey, honey, wait out there in the lobby. Be reverent. Isn't it awful?
Yes, doesn't it look lovely?
Well, I suppose, Virgil, I mean it.
Well, I think he makes a lovely looking corpse. I do. Don't you think he looks nice?
No, I don't. Virgil, that's to sign your name and not to draw in with it. No. Well, Pearl, I just don't know what to say. One dead body just looks like another dead body to me. Just look dead. Still waxing.
Virgil, but I'm gonna knock you in the next week if you pick another flower. Come on, go. Wait in the station wagon with Tommy.
Vera, that boy's not right.
Glass houses. Well, Pearl,
Judge Buckner has met his maker at last.
In a Dale Evans swimsuit. Judge, I don't believe I can stand it. Oh, the fox went out one stormy night. He prayed for the moon to give him light. He said, I've got many miles to go before I reach the town, oh, town, oh, town, oh.
Guess who?
Well,
don't you look just like yourself? Don't you, though, Your Honor? Dead. You can't imagine how safe I feel. Of course, I had a lot of time to think about it while I was in reform school. Yeah, it's about the only thing I can say for Gatesville. There's plenty of time to think. Judge, why do you think I'd nuzzle up to that homely housekeeper of yours? God, Yolanda. She thought I was in love. Well, I kept it up, yeah. I kept it up till I got me a copy of all of her keys and I got all my information bit by bit, you know, like her schedule and your schedule. And at one hour on Wednesday morning when you were all alone, she went to buy groceries.
Yeah.
Found out about that. I set you up. I just parked across the street from the Piggly Wiggly and waited. And I seen Yolanda go into that store, and I done a beeline to your house. I drove right up the curving driveway, walk out to the goddamn front door, right up the stairs to your bedroom, and all you could do was lay there on your half-paralyzed ass and stare, but you knew what I was there for, didn't you? You knew.
Man, it was hell getting you in that swimsuit.
Oh, it was worth it.
You know what my favorite part was? Huh? Huh? You don't know what my favorite part was, Your Honor? My favorite part's when I pulled out that syringe and you started pleading with me. You pleading with me, goddammit.
All it took to finish you off is a few air bubbles right in the vein. Just a few little air bubbles.
Stroke. I guess we're even.
Why don't I feel like it, huh?
You know what? You know what? Someday after my mama's dead, I may just turn myself in. Who won't everybody be surprised? God damn. I can hear them now. Why, who would have thought Stanley Buemiller had the brains to pull that off?
Shit.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Tuna. This is Thurston Wheelis, and this is the Wheelis Struve Midday Report. And first off in the news, they're going to have a meeting of the smut snatchers of the new order this afternoon down at the Coweta Baptist Church, starting about 5 o'clock. And radio station OKKK is going to carry that meeting live, so you tune in. Now, the smut snatchers' latest project is cleaning up those dictionaries down at Tuna High School. And they say if you know of a word that you feel has questionable value, or a word you feel just should not belong in the dictionary, well, if you don't want your child around the word, you bring the word to the meeting. That's right. Bring it to the meeting, the Reverend Spike says. He'll consider each word on a word-by-word basis. And now, folks, we have a real special guest with us today. She's a senior at Tuna High School and the daughter of Hank and Bertha Buemiller here in Tuna, Miss Charlene Buemiller. Charlene is the winner of this year's annual Javelina Club's Poetry Writing Contest. And if she wins next month in Wichita Falls, she's going on to the national competition held up in Butte, Montana come February. Lord, why in the hell they want to have it there, I'll never know. Charlene says her poem registers her love and admiration for Tuna. Well, here's Charlene now, and her poem speaks for itself.
My Tuna by Charlene Buemiller. My Tuna, oh my Tuna, the only place I know. I've often thought of leaving you, but don't know where I'd go. For Paris has no barbecue, and Rome just can't compare to a lovely Texas sunset when the dust is in the air. Tuna, oh my Tuna, is such fun on Friday nights when the Jaguars lose another game and everybody fights. And I love you when you're frozen, and I love you when you're dry. And in April when the pollen is so thick it makes you cry. But Tuna, oh my Tuna, please stay just the way you are, because I just think the world outside of Tuna is bizarre.
That was real good, sweetheart. Real good. Well, I'll tell you, doesn't that just warm the cockles of your heart? Thank you, Charlene. We got a phone call today from Nadine Wooten's mother, Norma. She says that Nadine is standing out along the highway again with her suitcase. Well, now, as you folks know, about this time every year, poor Nadine stands out there along Route 4 with her suitcase. Now, don't try and pick her up, because she's only going to tell you she's waiting on Mr. Montague. But we thought we would remind you to look out for her. Don't run over her, and don't try and pick her up. Well, you know, it looks like it's that time of the year.
It is.
It is.
It is. Yes, it is. Well, folks, now next up in the news, Juanel Rainey is not dead.
No, she's not.
She's not. She's not. As y'all know, Juanel has been in the hospital for about the past 8 months with a combination of fatal diseases. I don't know. How many did she have?
Well, Arliss, I don't remember, but it was awful.
It was awful. Yeah. Hell, I thought she's going to die.
Yeah.
She thought she's going to die. We all thought she's going to die.
We did.
We did. We did. But she didn't.
No, she didn't.
She didn't, and she's home. She says, everybody come by and see her, give her a ring. She's not dead.
She's okay.
She is. Well, folks, now it's time for a little culture. Now, in keeping with the government's new policy of allowing private enterprise to contribute to America's artistic needs, radio station OKKK is proud to present the weekly Art Minute. And this week's guest is none other than Tuna's own R.R. Snavely. What you got for us today, R.R.?
Honky-tonk angels.
Honky-tonk angels. Take it away, R.R.
Artis, I got to warm up first.
Well, now, hurry up, R.R. You only got 40 seconds left. Thank you, R.R. Your minute is up. Wasn't that something, I tell you. For an old coot who sees unidentified flying chalupas, he plays a mean fiddle.
He does.
Next up, Maxie Bovine, the reigning Miss Tuna in the Miss Texas pageant, has had a real run of bad luck. It seems her talent competition went over by 20 seconds. Maxie, as you know, does the famous Scarlett O'Hara, I'll never eat a root again, sing. And just as she got the root to her lips, the buzzer went off. Now, they say Maxie threw a wall-eyed fit, and she's still in the hospital suffering from shock. But we talked to her chaperone, Mildred Jean Perkins. She said Maxie'd be there for that swimsuit competition tomorrow night, and she's got that body hair problem under control. That gal's a trooper.
She is.
And from our national news desk, nuclear accident imperils millions in 7 states. Texas not included.
Well, all right.
That's all the news we got for you.
That's it.
Don't touch that dial.
Don't touch that dial. Get away from it.
Get away from it. Tuna Speaks is next.
This is Petey Fisk speaking to you for the Greater Tuna Humane Society. And you know, we receive a whole lot of flack here at the Humane Society saying we're insensitive to the needs of fish. Now, this is not true. We care a great deal about fish. We understand whenever you take a fish out of water with a hook in its mouth and rip it through its jaw and take out a knife and stick it in its anal opening and cut up to its neck and scrape its insides out, that fish feels that. Fish feel pain. They're just very, very subtle about expressing it. Please join that growing number of Americans who prefer their fish in rivers and streams and not on a plate with tater tots. This is Petey Fisk speaking to you for the Greater Tuna Humane Society. Thank you.
This is Elmer Watkins on Tuna Speaks. As a citizen of Tuna, I feel it's my obligation to speak up about this Agent Orange stuff and its effects on servicemen. And I just want to say that in the last year, I hired 14 veterans, Vietnam veterans, to work for me on my road crew. Now, of those 14, only 4 of them have died, but there wasn't a one of them that turned orange. I swear to God, not a one of them turned anyways near orange, and I think it's more of this propaganda by this liberal press and these hippie-oriented groups. And I think it's time somebody spoke up about this Agent Orange stuff. This is Elmer Watkins on Tuna Speaks. Thank you.
Welcome to the Coweta Baptist Church, where everybody's welcome, even Catholics. Oh, what a lovely outfit. Do you know I used to have one just like that years ago? Isn't it wonderful how some people can just wear anything? Well, I thought you were dead. I don't even remember who told me that, but I'm so glad they were wrong. I, Vera Karp, Vice President of the Smut Snatchers of the New Order, in the absence of our President, the Reverend Spikes, do declare this meeting to be officially open. Now, we have a communique to release from our education committee. Now, after all the vicious, vicious things that have been said about us in the newspapers, we've decided to become more flexible on bilingual education. And we do indeed have a bilingual education program to present to the Tuna schools. The difference is our program is one of moderation. It entails learning the following Spanish phrases. Habla usted inglés? Which means, do you speak English? Cuánto, which means how much? Donde puedo cambiar este cheque? Which is, where can I cash this traveler's check? Por favor, envíme ubutones para recoger mi equipaje. Which is, please send me a boy for my luggage. And the last one is no hay pedido esto, which is, I didn't order this. Now, that's all the Spanish any red-blooded American ought to feel obligated to learn. Thank you. And let's just see the newspapers make fun of that. Well, he's still not here, so I'm just gonna forge ahead. We need to send out a snatch squad. Well, we do. We need to send out a book snatching squad to check those dictionaries at the Tuna High School Library. Now, some of those words are considered possibly misunderstandable or offensive to pre-college students. Now, the words are hot, hooker, coke, clap, deflower, ball, knocker, and nuts. Now, after much prayer and soul searching with the Lord, the committee has decided not to include the word snatch on the list. Now, we understand that many of you have very strong feelings about snatch. But we just can't afford to change our letterheads at this time. Well, finally, I now turn our meeting over to our honorable president, the Reverend Spines.
Thank you, Vera. I'm sorry, folks. I am sorry I'm so late. But let's get right down to business. Now, we're going to send out a book snatching squad to the Tuna High School Library
I already told them that.
Vera, that's all the fun of being president, is sending out the snatch artist.
Well, I'm sorry. I won't do it again.
Please don't. Now, folks, we have a new communique on our bilingual educational...
I already told them that, too.
You just told him everything, didn't you?
Well, what'd you expect me to do for 15 minutes while you weren't here singing show tunes?
Now, Barry, I'm not going to get into this power struggle right here in front of all these people, and I think the best thing to
do. Hush. The radio people are here.
Well, so they are. Hello, Arliss. How are you? Fine. How's that? Are we ready with the Buckner eulogy?
Of course.
Yes, Arliss, we're ready with that Judge Buckner eulogy. Now, tell you what, now, you set it up right back there, and when you're ready, you just kind of wave your hand. You're ready. Well, no, I'm ready. Are we live? Okay. This is the Reverend Spikes, and I just want to say a few words about a friend of mine and a friend of Tuna's, Roscoe Buckner. Spent his whole life in service to his community, his country, and his Lord. And we're sure that when that roll is called up yonder, he'll be there. He was a judge who made hay while the sun shined. But always, and I say always, letting a smile be his umbrella. For he always kept his sunny side up. And he always saw the silver lining behind every cloud. He was a judge who took no wooden nickels, nor threw caution to the wind. But he looked before he left, and he never got in over his head. No, he kept his head when all about him were losing theirs and blaming it on him. He kept a stiff upper lip and his nose to the wheel. About this man, we can truly say He was one of a kind, a jolly good fellow, which nobody can deny. For he was all for one and one for all and to his own self true. And I can tell you this, he did it his way. He was a serious-minded judge who let bygones be bygones, but remembered the Alamo. About this man, we can truly say he was the cream in Tuna's coffee. He fought fire with fire. He kept the home fires burning. And when he couldn't stand the heat, he got out of the kitchen. And he would walk that extra mile. He would walk it softly. And he carried a big stick. He was a pepper, a man's man, early to bed, early to rise. He laid his cards on the table. He gathered at the river and he brought in the sheaves. Hunger was his best pickle.
What the devil is that now?
Gosh, they're off. He was a judge who never fired until he saw the whites of their eyes. No, but he whistled a happy little tune and he praised God and he passed that ammunition. For he had yet begun to fight, for never, ever, ever did I ever hear the man say die. He just did. He was a fine, upstanding civil servant who practiced what he preached, who put his best foot forward in his money where his mouth was. And when the going got tough, he was gone. It's not easy. I say it's not easy to find the words to describe such a man. But I've done my best. We commend his soul to you, Lord. I, the Reverend Spikes, recommend him. Amen, Lord, amen. What's that, Arliss? Oh, no. Well, okay. This is the Reverend Spikes, and I just want to say, a few words. A few words about a friend of mine and a friend of two.
This is Thurston Wheelis with a sports flash. This just in, the Tuna High School Jaguars lost their season opener against the Colberg Comanches. It was a hard-fought contest, but in the end, the Purple and Green Cats were on the short end of a 48-0 score. Coach Raymond Chassie evaluated the loss this way.
Well, we lost mainly because we couldn't score. But the fact that they made 7 touchdowns was a major factor in the loss also. I don't know which one was a bigger factor, but you take away them 2 things and it would have been a tie. So I'm real proud of our boys anyway.
This is Arliss Scroovy with the crime report. Now, according to statistics, crime is down in the Greater Tuna area from this time last year. Now, this time last year, there were 6 arrests, and this year so far, we've only had 4. Now, Sheriff Givens says, though the numbers may still seem high, there's no reason for alarm over Tuna's high crime rate. He says it's mostly the same people getting arrested over and over and over again. Here we have Sheriff Givens himself in an interview taped early this morning.
Yeah, well, I don't run no country club, that's for sure. Where I come from, jail's supposed to be a, you know, an unpleasant experience. And I think it still should be, I really do. And I'll tell you one thing, you can call me old-fashioned, but a couple of 100 years ago, law enforcement was a much more rewarding profession than it is today.
The sheriff's remarks were recorded early this morning at the Dewey County Jail.
Here we go again. Seems like some people can't stay out of trouble now, can they?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Man, now, you wouldn't put me on, would you, Stanley? You wouldn't do that to me.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I got evidence, boy. I got proof. I got everything I need to know about you, son. Yeah, some people are just destined for a life in crime. You know how much money the state spent on you, boy, to rehabilitate you? Just look at you. You're what we call a habitual.
Hey. You gonna charge me with anything?
Yeah, I'm gonna charge your ass, son. First of all, I want to talk to you about this. Now, Stanley, I want to know what you're doing with the hypodermic needle in your car. You doing drugs, boy?
Come over here. Come over here. Look at my arms.
Well, come on. Look at them. Look, look, look. Close you want to. Why don't you put a magnifying glass up to my arms? There ain't no needles in my arms.
Stan, I want to know what you're doing with the needle in your car.
Because my mama's got diabetes. I carry an extra needle around in case she has a fit. There ain't been nothing in that needle but air, Sheriff. Nothing but air. Anything wrong having a hypodermic needle full of air? Sheriff said against the law.
Yeah, you think you're real smart now, don't you, boy? Yeah, you think you're real smart. Well, let me tell you something, Stanley. I got a witness. That's right, Viamella, I got a witness. And I wouldn't say you're too smart, son. You're kind of
hey,
never
you don't charge me with anything.
Yeah, I'll go charge your ass. Now, you might think we're just a bunch of stupid old country boys, son, but we wouldn't keep an eye on you.
You charge me, you do it.
Yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it right now. There you go, Stanley. Traffic tickets, two of them. One for speeding 40 in a 20 zone, the other for no turn signal. Now, son, the next time you take your land out joyriding, I think you better watch yourself. Now, you're going to stay right where you are till I get $41.27. Now, just how smart do you think you are now, Buemiller? Damn fool. Good night, boy. No way enough, Stanley. That telephone rings. Don't you bother.
Oh, dear God. I know that I've done some things in my life I shouldn't have done. And Lord, I know you have forgiven me time and time again. But Lord, just this once I ask you, please to God, don't ever let Henry find out about that bird dog. Amen. Stanley, answer the phone. I know you're home. I'm all out of strychnine, and I know you've got some. Well, I guess I'll just have to wait till tomorrow. I don't sleep as well knowing there's no strychnine in the house.
Childers with the Tuna Bulletin Board. Now, if you have any young'uns between the ages of 8 and 14, you need to know that Thursday is your last day to register your kids for Colonel Sprayberry's Character Camp and Survival Institute. Now, this year, they're offering classes in Old Testament appreciation, segregation in the scriptures, Christian biology, character development, and the proper use of firearms. So you register your kids today, it will do them some good.
I know that you've been fooling around on me right from the start.
Jody, you listen to that damn thing too much, son. I'm going to leave it off. I'm going out to check on them hired hands. You want to make sure they ain't out of getting drunk. They need to be home resting for the job. Son, I'm going to be coming in late tonight. You tell your mama.
Don't you tell mama.
Because I told you to. And I want that damn thing off.
Hank?
He's gone, Mama.
Gone, honey? Gone where?
Well, he went out to check on them hired hands, make sure they ain't out getting drunk.
Well, Jody, come on up to bed now, honey.
Mama, can I stay up for just a little while, listen to the radio?
Jody, you heard me.
Oh, Mama, I don't want to stay up all night, just half an hour.
Jody?
Mama.
And, honey, I don't want you coming downstairs in the middle of the night, sleeping on the couch and leaving the radio on all night.
All right, Mama.
Good night, baby.
Good night. You're going to get us in hot water.
Jody, honey, the puppy is whining.
Mama, I'm taking care of it.
Jody, put the puppy out now.
All right, Mama.
And say your prayers.
I will, Mama.
I'm listening.
Dear God, thank you for the puppy. And thank you for summer vacation. God bless Mama. Amen.
And leave the puppy outside. Oh, I swear, went out to check on the hired hands, huh? Well, that's a new one. I know he spent a long time thinking that one up. Lord, I need help. I need strength. But you know, Lord, last week I bought a gun. And Lord, you've got to give me the strength not to buy any bullets. Amen. We made. You promised me that if you didn't get cheerleader, you would quit that practicing. So quit.
All right, Mother.
Good night, baby. Now say your prayers.
I don't even know why I'm talking to you. The way I look at it, I've had 7 years, 3 in junior high, 4 in high school to be cheerleader. I prayed to you till my knees are flat and nothing. Well, I'm giving notice. I'm becoming an official agnostic. Try that on. Amen.
RR.
Hey! Where in the hell are you?
RR?
Dee Dee, I swear I saw it, Dee Dee.
Yeah. Sure you did, RR. You saw that hovering chalupa? You and Mogan David.
Well, now, baby, I want drinks when I saw that thing.
Shut up! God!
swear to God, if Mama was dead and I wasn't such a hard shell Baptist, I swear to God I'd divorce your ass.
Good evening, Tuna. This is Thurston Wheeler.
And this is Arliss Struvey.
And this is the Wheeler
Struvey
Bedtime Report. And now for the news, take it away, Arliss.
Well, actually, we had a lot of news, but we lost it. We did.
We did?
We did, we did.
Well, did you look under the table?
I've looked everywhere, and I can't find it. But we'll be back in a minute. We'll find it, and we'll have it for you.
Well, did you look over here?
Well, where in the hell did I put that thing?
All right, everybody, let's settle down now and begin this meeting. First, let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Lord, we just want to drop you a line, let you know we're still dedicated to doing your work. We still believe in making this world a better place for the right kind of people. Amen.
Listen. Here it is. Any animal that cannot be adopted within a reasonable amount of time must be destroyed at state expense. Destroying the animal is the only humane recourse. Now yippee. You can't say I haven't tried. You've been pet of the week 5 times. That's a record. And I'd love to keep you, but I got to stop somewhere. I mean, it's getting crowded here with the animals already gotten. The ducks are just starting to arrive. Now, would you just stop it? I mean, now, quit it. How can I put you out of your misery if you're wagging your tail? Come on, yeah. That's right, you got me, you can stay. Go on out there in the backyard and play. Hey, don't bark at Ruth. Snakes are very sensitive. Well, I don't know if there's anybody up there. I never have understood much about religion, but if you are, I'd like to ask a few favors for the animals. Now, I'm doing the best I can, but I got 2 dozen dogs. Now, I don't even have a count on the cats, and there's the ducks and Ruth and Yippee and... And the other thing is, well, hunting season's just around the corner, and that means the nightmares are going to start again. Now, after I hear the first shot, the nightmares start, and they don't stop till November, and I hate to bother you with it, I really do. But if you are up there, and you did create all of this, well, we could sure use some help taking care of it. Thank you.
Amen.
Well, now, hell, it's got to be here someplace.
Well, did you look out in the car?
Yeah.
Did you look in the icebox?
Oh, hell. I've looked everywhere and I can't find it.
Now, let's look out back in the trash.
Well, folks, I tell you, we've lost the news.
We have.
We have. Yeah. We have, we have. I give up, coach. Take me out. I can't find the news. So we're going to say good night to you.
Good night.
And we'll see you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.
Until then, remember our motto here at Radio OKKK. If you can find some place you like better than tuna, move.
Go on.
Get out of here.
Let's go.